was amazing, guys. Thank y'all.
Atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere is changing.
Your King. Please stand and worship with us this morning. We're going to teach you a new one.
I'll praise you on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure. I'll praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered. I'll praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water my enemies drowned in.
You that part, and then we'll add the chanting shouts next time for those of you who are missing those parts. So welcome here. I do see we have some mission trip brave people that came. They got in super late last night, so good morning to you guys. We look forward to hearing your guys' stories. Let's give a service to God. Father God, we just want to thank you that you are so good and so worthy of our praises, God. Just have your way in the service this morning in your name. Amen. Let's continue to worship.
darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophet. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Let's lift him up this morning. Sing it out.
You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone deserve our praise. You're the name above all names. Be exalted now in the heavens as your glory fills this place. You alone.
Church, and welcome here today. We're so glad you've joined with us. If you're visiting, stick around and check it out. This just might be the church for you and your family. We want to invite you to celebrate Easter with us. Of course, next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and then on Good Friday, March 29th at 10:30 a.m., we'll have a service here, and then join us, of course, as we celebrate our risen Savior on Easter Sunday, the 31st of March. Mark your calendars. It's that time of year again for the annual general meeting. Monday, April 8th at 7 p.m. in the lower level here at the church. Everyone is welcome to attend, so check that out. Hey, I'm going to invite Pastor Stewart. He's got some announcements for the youth ministry, so if you're in grade 6 to 12, listen up.
So this week we have a couple things that are going to look a little different. On Wednesday, our junior youth is not going to be here. Instead, we're going to be meeting at NCF at 7 o'clock. We're going to have a fun night. We're going to play Gargons. We're going to have a snack and have a great devotion. So please meet us there at 7 o'clock. On Friday, we have our big community dance, music, party here at Sun City. So join us. Doors open at 7. We're starting at 7:30. Come out for a fun, energy-filled night. That's for grades 8 through 12. So if that's you, we'd love to see you on Friday.
Also, for the girls' ministry with Kayla Moffitt, listen, they're going to kick off the spring break with a sleepover on Sunday the 24th at 7 p.m. at Sun City, but you can only attend if you fill out the online permission slip. So if you didn't receive an email from the church with that form for permission, talk to Kayla today to make sure you have it. This is for girls in grade 6 through 12, so plan to attend. It'll be an excellent way to kick off the spring break. For the adults, also lots going on. We have the XO Marriage Conference coming up on April 12th and 13th. Then we have the men's retreat the end of April at Red Rock Bible Camp. Also the IF Gathering the first weekend in May for the women's ministry. Please, before you leave today, stop by the Life Central desk for more information and to sign up for any of these events that pertain to you. All right, lots going on here at the church. And again, I'm going to say it, even though I said it when we recorded there. Welcome here, and if you're visiting,
Hey, we know you had options, so thanks for joining with us this morning. We hope that you had an incredible time of worship with the team. Thank you guys so much for leading us in worship this morning. Just phenomenal. And don't everyone clap at once for the word. Yeah. Do a slow clap. Anyway, we are, you won't realize probably until at the end of the message, or maybe you wouldn't even clue into this, without any conversation with Mel and the team, how much these songs we sang today are intertwined into my message. So just phenomenal how God does that. He starts speaking to us the moment we start, the moment we gather to worship together in this place. The Lord is speaking to us, and a conversation is taking place as we sing His praises back to Him, and then He encourages us with His word, and it's just incredible. So when you come to church, plan to get in here and hear from God from the very beginning. I have a couple of announcements that weren't on that video. So coming up on March 26th, that's in not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday, for the men's ministry, we've come to the end of our Tim Tebow study, and so on the 26th, we're going to plan or the men's ministry is planning a bowling night. So there'll be more information to come, an email, and then a sign-up sheet next week. But men, mark your calendars. On the 26th, we're going to have an outing as a men's ministry. We're going to go bowling, and then 2 weeks after that, we'll start another study here in the lower level of the church. But anyway, that's for the men's ministry. And then I want to say that congratulations are in order for Daniel and Jenna Weeb. I'm not sure if they're here this morning or not, but and they have welcomed another baby girl into their home, so a little sister for Sadie, and her name is Hannah Faith Weeb, and she was born on Monday, so welcome and congratulations to the Weeb family on their new addition. Yes. And before we get into the Word of God, let me just pray, and then we'll get going with our message. Father, thank you so much again for your presence in this place. We gathered in here to worship you and to make much of you. And so, Father, as we do that, we just thank you that your Holy Spirit lives in us and is present to work in our midst, Lord. And we just ask him to do that. And, Father, we pray for our children's ministry. Pray for the offering. We just pray for all the aspects of our church family life and the things that are going on. For the unspoken prayer requests that may be represented in this room, we bring them before you, Father God, and ask you to intervene in the ways only you can. And we thank you. We give you this service in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So let's get into the Word of God together. We've been plodding along, I'm going to say, on a series called Build My Church. And as much as people hate recaps, we're going to do a little recap. But very brief, just so I can get us caught up to where we are today in case this is your first time here during this sermon series. And so we started in the book of Haggai, and we talked about the children of Israel, the Jewish nation rebuilding the temple after being in exile in Babylon for 70 years. They're back, and God says, build my church or build my house. And so they go to work building and rebuilding Solomon's temple. And so we took a quick diversion from there and went all the way back to Moses and the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, the first gathering place for the people of God and for the Jewish nation. And so the purpose behind that was to see that when they built the tabernacle, when they were done, it was designed for the presence of God to live there and to dwell there. And so we read the story and we looked into it. And once they were done, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, filled that with a cloud by day and a fire by night. And whenever the Spirit lifted and moved, they packed up and they moved as they were in the wilderness heading toward the promised land. Then we looked at Solomon's temple because of the differences in the two and how incredible the Solomon's temple was. And again, the Spirit of God filled the temple. It was God's plan all along to dwell among his people. Then we know Jesus was sent. Why? The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And so Jesus comes on the scene, and he is the one who the scriptures say will baptize with fire and with the Holy Spirit. And so then we talked about the beginnings of the church, which is where we're going in the book of Acts this morning, finally. And he says, Peter is going to be this instrumental part and this foundation stone, if you will, in the early church. And so we took a couple of weeks and we just looked at Peter's rise from obscurity, from a fisher of people to becoming a fisher of men, and then his temptation to turn back and go forth, and then God reinstates Jesus reinstates Peter after he had denied him three times. And then we're going to go today into the book of Acts and see what happened at the day of Pentecost with the Holy Spirit again designing and desiring to dwell among us. And now, because Jesus has gone to the Father, we're going to see through Scripture that the Spirit of God is poured out and lives in you and I. Again, the Spirit of God fills the temple, and we now are the temple of the Lord. Right? Yeah. Good recap without looking at my notes. Oh, I missed seven things. Hold on. And we're going to play a little game this morning because I'm going to get all my jokes out of the way right now, and then because we've got so much scripture we're going to go through, because it's important to me that you don't only hear what I think about this topic, but what does the Bible say? And then you can draw some conclusions and some stuff, and you'll have lots of things to think about this week, I guarantee you. But I was going to say we should start a little game that's unspoken. We'll just play because people make fun of me every week. Not make fun, that people joke with me every week. So we're going to play a game, and it's just simply, and you can write it in your Bible or in your notes or in your phone or just in your own head, that what is shinier, my shoes or my head? We'll just start this game every week. You can just go, oh, this week it's the shoes, and when I wear sneakers, it'll be my head. But anyway, the light, it's just the lighting. It's just the lighting. But let's get into the Word of God together. Let's get into the book of Acts. I'm going to go right to Acts 1, verses 48. I think you're on slide 11 to start. Yeah, see? So organized. Verses 48, we're getting into the day of Pentecost, but I want to reiterate what was going on here. Now Jesus has ascended to the Father. He's not coming back. Well, he's coming back, but he's not coming back to talk to his disciples again. Instead, he's going to send the promised Holy Spirit. Here's how it went down. Here's how the church that we are now associated with got its start. It says, on one occasion while he was eating with them, this is Jesus, he gave them this command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? See, they just wanted him to establish his kingdom now. And they just couldn't get it through their heads that it wasn't going to go that way. He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. All right. Peter now has been reinstated, and we get to Jesus just told them what was going to happen, and here's what happened. So we're going to Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 8. Like I said, lots of scripture. You might want to get out your phone, unless you're a note taker, then just use pen and paper, and write down the scriptures today, because there's going to be lots of them that you might want to go back and read what's before and a little bit after, because to make it, try to fit into one Sunday and done, because no matter what happens this week, next Sunday we start our celebration into Easter. We're going to have a Palm Sunday service, and then we're going to have, of course, Good Friday, Easter Sunday, and then on the 7th of April, mark your calendars, the missions team, who praise the Lord, I know Mel mentioned it, all back safe and sound, they're going to be sharing with us from their trip and their experience. So that's on the 7th, and then we'll get back wherever we're at. Anyway, Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost, lots of scripture was my point. Write them down because you might want to go over these yourself and do a little further study. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in their bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Amazing. Utterly amazed, yep, they asked, aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Okay, so they're in this place. Peter has stood up and preached. The day of Pentecost shows up there in one place. The Holy Spirit is poured out. So after Peter has preached and explained all the things concerning Jesus as the Messiah, he concludes his sermon this way in Acts chapter 2, 36 to 41. So this happens. Peter boldly stands up and preaches, and he ends his message this way. 36 to 41, sorry. Therefore, Peter speaking, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. So this was our Peter that was kind of, he is now this rock that Jesus called him, Petra or Cephas or Peter, which means rock. And now he is stepping into this role permanently. There's no record of him now going back fishing other than maybe for recreational. It's not recorded. I'm not saying he never fished again. I'm just saying he lived and died for his faith and to preach the gospel. And anyway, therefore, when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and all the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord your God will call. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to the number, to their number, that day. Now, that is a pretty impressive sermon in terms of church growth, right? That's a pretty good, 3,000 people are added to the church that day. They repent, are filled with the Spirit, and are added to our number, and this is the start of the church. Now, it's important that we acknowledge that this is not due to Peter's giftedness. He wasn't this amazing orator. He hadn't had any specific theological education other than 3 amazing years with Jesus, which should do it. But it's not him alone. This is Peter and the Holy Spirit. And I think that the Holy Spirit gets the lion's share of the credit. In fact, in Acts 4:8, I don't have this for the screen, but it says, then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, spoke to the crowd. This boldness that we were told in Acts 1 that would give us the confidence and the ability to preach our faith, the power to be witnesses wherever we go. This is one of the main key roles of the Holy Spirit. And we see it happening right away after the Holy Spirit has been poured out. Now, this is the first example of you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses, that was Acts 1:8. So let's look into the day of Pentecost, okay? Now, some think that this is a one-time event of the fulfilling of the prophecy in Joel 2:28. And if you go back and read the rest of Acts chapter 2, you'll know that Peter actually quoted this. So people think this is a one-time fulfilling of the prophecy in Joel that said, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. And your young men will see visions. However, this filling of the Holy Spirit for supernatural things is seen elsewhere in the Scriptures. And if you remember way back when we kind of started this series, I talked about having 2 or 3 witnesses in order to establish a case. This was like in a court of law. Well, the same principle, I think, is a good benchmark for studying Scriptures. Don't just take a verse and build a whole theology around a verse. Instead, look and see if there's at least not 2, 3, 4, 5 other instances where what you were thinking is something to build a case for, there are other witnesses of it in Scripture, because God is very repetitive in telling us what he wants to do in different ways throughout the Scriptures. And so we're going to look at a couple of those. So in the past, God in the Old Testament and in Jesus' day before he ascends to the Father, the Holy Spirit was still poured out on people to do special tasks, but now Jesus has ascended to the Father, the promised Holy Spirit can then be poured out on all people. And so we read, when we accepted Christ, we are filled with the Spirit. It is the Spirit of God that lives in us. What I want you to think about today And if you're one of those who likes to go home and take the scriptures and study them and see, I want you to consider if there is biblical evidence, and we're going to go into this further, bear with me, if there's biblical evidence of a separate event of being filled with the Spirit other than just at the time of salvation. I believe that at the time of salvation, when you accept Christ, you repent, the Spirit of God comes and lives inside of you. But scripturally, is there other instances where the Holy Spirit was poured out or given to people for different tasks and different things? So we're going to look at that. Is baptism in the Spirit something that is different, since John said, the one coming after me will baptize you with fire and with the Holy Spirit? We have water baptism here. We haven't yet brought a barbecue big enough to get some baptism by fire, and so we're not going to go there, but let's look at this whole idea of what that means, because it is over and over in the Gospels that Jesus was be the one that could baptize us with fire and the Holy Spirit. Anyway, so first of all, we're going to go all the way back to the tent of meeting, the tabernacle. I want to observe something interesting that I purposely didn't put emphasis on back when we were doing this, because I knew we were getting to this, and that's found in Exodus 31, verses 1 to 5. So this is Moses is being instructed by God to have the tent of meeting, the tabernacle, built to house the presence of God in the Ark of the Covenant. Okay? So here's what went down. Then the Lord said to Moses, "See, I have chosen Bezalel, son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, and I have filled him with the Spirit of God, wisdom, with understanding, with knowledge, and with all kinds of skills, to make artistic designs for working gold, silver, and bronze, to cut and set stones, to work in wood, and to engage in all kinds of crafts." Okay, he was chosen and filled with the Holy Spirit and given wisdom and knowledge and skills. I'm filled with the Spirit, exempt from skills when it comes to building things and crafting. So, as we'll read in Corinthians, the Holy Spirit gives different gifts to different people, but there's incidences throughout Scripture where the Holy Spirit was given to people to do extraordinary things. Think of Samson. Think of this particular passage. To build, okay? In Luke chapter 1, and again, there's no slides for this on the screen, but if you write Luke 1 in your notes, you can go back and read the whole thing. I'm just going to point out a couple of scriptures. In Luke chapter 1, we have the account of the angel Gabriel showing up to visit Zechariah, who's serving in the temple, and the angel shows up to him and says, "Your wife Elizabeth is going to have a son, and you're to name him John." So an angel shows up in the temple, tells Zechariah he's going to have a son, name him John. This is John the Baptist, okay? Luke 1:15 says about John the Baptist, "For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born." Filled with the Holy Spirit even before he's born. John the Baptist, okay? Later, when Mary, who is pregnant with Jesus, visits her cousin Elizabeth, Luke 1:41 says, "When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby, John the Baptist, leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit." Now you can read the rest of Luke chapter 1 to find out what the filling of the Holy Spirit, then she prophesied, and she talks about Jesus. And so you can read that on your time. At the birth of John the Baptist, his father, Zechariah, it says, was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, and you can check that out in Luke chapter 1, 67 to 80. Have I established a few testimony or witnesses that show us that the Holy Spirit and God can put his Spirit on whomever he wants for whatever time he wants, and yet these are times before Jesus has gone to the Father, when then the promised Holy Spirit is going to pour out so that we can all experience the Spirit of God in our daily lives. Make sense? Still with me? Okay. The point that I'm making is that the Holy Spirit has been involved with humanity from the beginning of time, but in a limited capacity. But now that Jesus has ascended, the Holy Spirit has been given to us in greater measure. Now here is a few scriptures of what Jesus had to say about the Holy Spirit. Luke chapter 11, verse 11 to 13 says, Jesus speaking, which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, would give him a snake instead? Or if he asked for an egg, would give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Now, if I'm already accepted Christ and filled with the Holy Spirit, how much more will it be if we ask for the Holy Spirit, will he be given to us? Luke 24, 49. Jesus speaking again said, I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. These are the guys that have walked with Jesus. Now again, he has not yet ascended to the Father. Okay? John chapter 1, 29 to 34. The next day, John was in the Jordan. He says, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. Remember, John the Baptist came baptizing a baptism of repentance, and for so people to repent, he was the forerunner to Christ coming. That was his job, and he had a spirit of Elijah. Then John gave this testimony, and this is when he baptized Jesus. This is the testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. And I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one. Flip over to John chapter 14. This one's a bit longer. 12 to 27. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me, Jesus speaking, will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I'll do it. If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in the Father and you are in me and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, said, but Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus replied, anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teachings. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. A couple more quick verses in John. John 15, 26 and 27. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. And then John 16, 17, sorry, lots of scripture. I just want to unpack this before we get into what took place at the day of Pentecost, and we're going to get into that in a moment. But John 16, 7 to 15, 16, sorry, John 16, 7 to 15. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. This is why you might want to write these down and go over them in your own time so you can kind of, it sounds kind of riddle-ish, but if you take it and meditate on it and look into it, all that belongs to the Father is mine, Jesus said. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he's going to make known to you. Okay, so, all right. Wow, that's a lot of Bible. That's a lot of verses about the Holy Spirit. And I may be the only one that thinks along these lines, and I could be wrong. But I think that most Christians understand and have a clear sort of understanding and relationship with God the Father. We recognize God the Father as creator of all things, this omniscient, omnipotent being who created all things and created us, who holds everything together through his son Jesus, right? We have no problem with God the Father because we can get into the Word of God. We can sort of understand him a little bit. The Gospels and the New Testament has certainly helped us to understand what the Father is like because Jesus lived according to what the Father did and according to what the Father said. And so we have this visual picture of Jesus being the Son of God, God in the flesh, living it out before us. And so we have this understanding of the Father. Okay, we can see how he works now. We can see the compassion. We can see the love for people through Jesus. So we can kind of draw a conclusion around God the Father because we have this evidence in Scripture of him. And then we are all big fans of Jesus, right? He's our favorite. Right, Jesus is the favorite. I mean, he died on the cross for us, keeping in mind that the three are one. He's a triune Trinity God, but we can associate easily with Jesus. We recognize his life and incredible how he lived. His teaching amazed people, still amazes people. And then the fact that he would die and not only that, rise again the third day, and we'll be celebrating that in a couple of weeks. And so we have no problem with Jesus. We love Jesus. And I'm not saying we have a problem with the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit is the one where when we start to talk about the Holy Spirit, we kind of, okay, I believe I'm filled with the Spirit of God. I believe that when we sing those songs, Spirit come and move in our midst. I believe he does that. I believe that the Holy Spirit leads and guides us into all truth. I believe it is him that led me to or you to wherever it is where you heard the gospel for the first time and accepted Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, but there's lots of aspects of the Holy Spirit that we don't understand because lots of stuff in the Christian church has been done in the name of the Holy Spirit that seems odd to us or scary. And it's okay that it seems scary, but we shouldn't be afraid of it. Even in the Old Testament, when Moses went up on the mountain and God appeared to them, the people were terrified and said, you go see God and talk to us. We can't be in his presence. He'll destroy us. They were afraid. The Spirit of God descended in a cloud, spoke to them, and they said, you know what? Moses, you go up the mountain. We'll stay here and melt gold. We'll stay here. Because the Spirit of God can be scary seeming, but not to those of us who have a relationship with God and understand an understanding of the Scriptures and what it means. And so, let's dive into Acts chapter 2, this baptism in the Holy Spirit. Verse 5, you don't have to put it on the screen, or 3, they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, there were people from all over the place, and it says, how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language. And so I want to talk a little bit about the elephant in the room at the day of Pentecost, which is this whole idea of speaking in tongues. Now we're going to look and we're going to see in Corinthians that the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit gives gifts to people. Some will have the gift of speaking in tongues. Some will have the interpretation of tongues. Some will prophesy. And there's these different gifts and these different things. But let's talk about this Holy Spirit. Is this a one-time event that took place on the day of Pentecost? Now, I want you to realize in the world there are over 7,000 officially known languages. Over 7,000 languages in the world. And I bet most of us think we'll be speaking English in heaven. I will be. Or I will have the gift of interpretation and I'll know what everyone is saying. This instance at the day of Pentecost, this speaking in tongues was clearly people who didn't speak the same language were endowed with the Spirit of God for a one-time, the Spirit stayed in them, but for a one-time opportunity to speak languages that they did not know or study, and people were able to hear the gospel in their own language. That's what happened. They were speaking a language that was not their language. It'd be like me being sent on a mission trip somewhere, and all of a sudden the Spirit gives me the gift of speaking in tongues, and I speak in tongues, and there's people there that speak that language and can understand the gospel. I've been in one church service in my life, and I was only a teenager or early 20s, young adult, where I've seen that happen, where someone spoke in tongues, and then someone came forward because they heard the gospel in their own language and repented and accepted Christ. I've seen that happen one time in my life that way. The day of Pentecost happened in Acts 2. Then 8 years later, okay, we're going to look at Philip in Samaria. This is 8 years after the day of Pentecost. It says this, Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah there. When the crowds heard Philip and saw the signs he performed, they all paid close attention to what he said. For with shrieks, impure spirits came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed, so there was great joy in that city. Philip in Samaria, being used by God, healing's taking place, deliverance is taking place, awesome. First, skip down to Acts 8, verses 12 to 17. But when they believed Philip, as he proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself, now this is Simon the sorcerer. Again, if you write down these verses, you go check out this guy. Simon himself believed and was baptized. And he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles that he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to Samaria. When they arrived, they prayed for the new believers there that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit had not yet come on any of them, they had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. And this is where we start to have, like, none of us have a problem with Day of Pentecost talking about tongues and the Holy Spirit, because we can clearly see they're speaking language. But here's the two different views around tongues, okay? The view is that we have a gift of tongues, and you can speak another language, and there'll be and someone will hear the gospel in their own language, right? The other side of it is a prayer language. Speaking in tongues as a prayer language, or as something you felt the Spirit enabling you to do in a meeting like this, but the Scriptures say it is of no value unless there is an interpreter, someone to interpret what was said. So the question is there tongues that are the language, and is there tongues that is a prayer language? Okay, and that's for you to look at and study and come to your own conclusion on that. But we're looking at the Scriptures here. So look into it, okay? The word tongues is from the Greek word glousias or something. I can't pronounce it. Which means unintelligible sounds. So from the Greek to translate it to English, there wasn't a word. They used the word tongues, and it meant unintelligible sounds. Okay, so this is where we get the idea of this prayer language or this ability to speak in tongues when the Holy Spirit fills. And not everyone will speak in tongues. The Scriptures say that, but some will. And it's not something for us who don't speak in tongues or those who don't speak in tongues to be afraid of, and it's not anything for those who do speak in tongues to be ashamed of or to be worried about. It is a prayer language. Unless you speak in tongues in a public place, then the scriptures say everything should be done in order and there should be an interpretation of that tongues. Otherwise, it does no value to all of us sitting here to hear you pray in a language none of us know. Right? Make sense? All right. Keep going. 2 years later, after this incident with Philip in Samaria, so now we're 10 years after the day of Pentecost, Acts 10, 44 to 46, while Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on Gentiles, for they heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Which tongues was it? I'm not sure. Look into it further. 10 years later, so 20 years after, I'm reiterating this because a lot of people think this was a one-time event that happened on the day of Pentecost, and we're not seeing this Holy Spirit poured out in the same way. So now we're 20 years after the day of Pentecost. Acts 19, 1 to 6. While Apollos was at Corinth, Paul took the road through the interior and arrived at Ephesus. There he found some disciples and asked them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" That's what I believe. They answered, "No, we have not even heard that there is a Holy Spirit." So Paul asked them, "Then what baptism did you receive?" "John's baptism," they replied. Paul said, "John's baptism was a baptism of repentance. He told the people to believe in the one coming after him, that is, in Jesus. On hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul placed his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came on them, and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. There are about 12 men in all." So they spoke in tongues and prophesied. And there are only 12 men there. The chances of them being of a different language, I don't know. I don't know. This, to me, could be evidence of a prayer language of speaking in tongues that the Holy Spirit gives to some people as a gift. Like he gave Bezalel the gift of skills, but he didn't give me that gift. Right? We're told in Scripture, and I'm going to get there before, really quick, that not to pursue the gift of tongues, but prefer prophecy. Paul's conversion and baptism, that's Acts 9, verse 10, to Acts 12, verse 17. We're not going there. It's too much reading. It's too long. So if you're a note taker and you want to dig into this on your own and look into that, look at Paul's conversion with the results of the Holy Spirit happening in his life and what took place. It doesn't say in Paul's thing there in Acts, I'll just let you know, spoiler alert, it doesn't say that Paul spoke in tongues here. But 1 Corinthians 14, 1 to 19, I will read this. It says, "Follow the way of love and eagerly desire gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. For anyone who speaks in tongues does not speak to the people, but to God." You're not. So here to me is evidence of a prayer language where you're not speaking to people, you're speaking to God. "Indeed, no one understands them. They utter mysteries by the Spirit. But the one who prophesies speaks to people for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. Anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves, but the one who prophesies edifies the church. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets, so that the church can be edified. Now, brothers and sisters, if I come to you and speak in tongues, what good will I be to you unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or word of instruction? Even in the case of lifeless things that make sounds, such as the pipe or harp, how will anyone know what tune is being played unless there is a distinction in the notes? Again, if the trumpet does not sound a clear call, who will get ready for battle? So it is with you. Unless you speak intelligible words with your tongue, how will anyone know what you're saying? You will just be speaking into the air." Well, how would you just be speaking into the air if you're speaking in tongues and it's another language that someone else in the room may understand because it's their first language? "Undoubtedly, there are all sorts of languages in the world," I told you, 7,000 or more, "yet none of them is without meaning. If then I do not grasp the meaning of what someone is saying, I am a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker is a foreigner to me. So it is with you. Since you are eager for gifts of the Spirit, try to excel in those that build up the church. For this reason, The one who speaks in a tongue should pray that they may interpret what they say. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. So what shall I do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will also pray with my understanding. I will sing with my spirit, but I will also sing with my understanding. Otherwise, when you are praising God in the spirit, how can someone else who is now put in the position of an inquirer say amen to your thanksgiving, since they do not know what you are saying? You are giving thanks well enough, but no one else is edified. Then he says in verse 18, I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. But in the church, I would rather speak 5 intelligible words to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. The main point is we are called to build up and edify one another. If you have the gift of tongues, you want to have someone else here that has the gift of interpretation. If you speak in tongues, if you've been filled with the Holy Spirit and you are here and you speak in tongues, you want to use that as a prayer language. It says Romans 8, 26 and 27. I'm just going to finish this so we're done. I appreciate the extra few minutes here. Romans 8, 26 and 27 says, in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. So that is a whole lot of scripture and information for you to look at, spend time with the Lord in, speak with him. I think I am doing it justice by just going through the scriptures on what it says through the book of Acts, what the Holy Spirit was doing. There's other verses I didn't touch on, but you can look it up and see where people prayed in the Spirit and different things. But my point this morning is that we shouldn't be worried or afraid of the Holy Spirit. He lives in us. I am not the kind of person, because there's lots of things done in the name of the Holy Spirit, that is odd or different. And I'm not going to say a negative thing about people who practice that in other churches and that sort of thing, because I'm not going to speak about something. I'm not going to be down on something I am not up on. Okay? Does that make sense? When I think about the Holy Spirit moving, as I mentioned last week, I want to see lives transformed. When we see in the scriptures, in the book of Acts, the early church, when the Holy Spirit came on people and they spoke and all these things happened, lives changed, people repented and accepted Christ. It was very seldom, other than the fact that you get to benefit from the skills, like Bezalel did, or you get to benefit with a gift from the Holy Spirit. Other than that, it was always used to edify others. The Holy Spirit filling you and I, if we were to say right now, if I was just to pray, Father, we thank you for today, just fill this place with your Spirit, which we sang, which we do say, which we are all fine with, as far as I know, because we believe he's the third person of the Trinity, and I haven't said anything far out or crazy. In the scriptures, when the Spirit came, it always was to edify the group. It was never that one person would have some kind of holy moment for themselves. In your personal prayer time, yes. Yes, it will edify yourself. It says that in Scripture. If you're speaking in tongues in your own prayer time, you will be edified. But without an interpretation, no one else is. And so these are the gifts of the Spirit. You can look further into 1 Corinthians 14 and look at all that. But hey, thank you for the extra time. That's a lot to unpack this morning. Next week, join us for Palm Sunday. We are moving right along. I'm excited. I'm excited for our church over the Easter weekend, so plan to attend our services here on Good Friday and Easter Sunday as well. Let me pray for you, and you are dismissed. God bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May you walk in his ways this week, that everywhere you go, you'll be able to share your faith with boldness, because the Spirit of God lives in you. In Jesus' name, amen.